Sorry, we have some technical issues with the audio. And let's start again. Thank you for welcome and thank you for registering in this webinar about practical management of cases from the new EudraVigilance system. First of all, please let me introduce our company for that people that don't know about us. Asphalion is an international scientific and regulatory affairs consultancy with offices in Barcelona, Munich, and lately we have opened a new office in Madrid. We collaborate with pharma and biotech companies facilitating drug development and regulatory affairs projects for drugs, biologics, biosimilars, ATMPs, and medical devices. Our involvement ranges from early development through to registration and post-commercialization phases. Since the company was founded in 2000, we have consistently grown and now have a team of over 80 employees with backgrounds in all areas of life science. Our consultants are experts in their fields and are in direct contact with European agencies for the implementation of new regulatory standards. We provide global services and work for hundreds of clients from around the world. Through collaborations with partners in all other continents, we can accelerate your worldwide scientific and regulatory activities by using local expertise. Our services are regulatory and scientific strategy during development, medical and scientific writing, global submissions, e-submission and DREAM, life cycle outsourcing, pharmacovigilance, and promoting the marketing registration of medical devices. In the pharmacovigilance unit at Asphalion, we work together with the objective of giving our clients the best services, which are summarized in this slide. Now, let me introduce myself. I am Senior Drug Safety Officer in the Pharmacovigilance Unit, where some of the tasks that we perform are ICSR management and submission, Spanish local contact affairs, safety database implementation, signal detection, EQPPB, pharmacovigilance agreements review, PSMF, and PVSOP designing and writing, XEVMPD, literature searches, PCRs, and RMPs elaboration and reviews. Okay, so, but let's start with the webinar. We are going to go through all these topics, hopefully within the hour of this webinar. As you all already know, since 22nd of November last year, no more rerouting by EudraVigilance is done. Therefore, MAHs are invited to screen EV database in search of cases probably related with products belonging to MAHs portfolio. In order to perform this screening easily, the new EudraVigilance environment has put in place an ICSR download tool. Before performing the search, we have to design the filters parameters needed. Filters should be added in order to delimit the results. There are two types of filters: fixed filters. Reports, dates, seriousness, and organization type, and other filters that you can find in more criteria pick list that are active substance, reporter, country, worldwide ID, active substance group, active substance combination, active substance MLM group, and active substance MLM combination. Filter by reports, this filter has different options depending on the user that is logged in EVWeb. For users with normal access, only PV obligations reports and MLM reports could be selected. However, additional criteria are available for users with QPPB permissions granted. The option case narrative request should be requested only in the context of signal evaluation and other activities for protecting public health. It should not be requested for other purposes, such as deciding whether the ICSR should be entered into the MAHs own pharmacovigilance system or not. Regarding the filter dates, we should be aware that access to ICSRs through the download function is granted upon the successful classification of suspect drugs within an ICSR against XEVMPD data. When a medicinal product within ICSR is classified, the date of this classification is recorded in the database. This date is used for download date range calculation. This range should not be longer than 15 days. Regarding the organization type filter, who is not happy about this filter? I think that we all were looking for the agency to implement a filter like this since December last year. However, this filter is not completely effective, and EMA recommends in its last version of the release notes that the filter cannot be used for the moment. There are some optional filters. Among them, we have the primary source country filter, which will select all the reports for a given reported country that contains the field primary source for regulatory purposes checked. It isn't exactly the occurring country field, but in most of the cases, it is the same. Okay, furthermore, the active substance group filter uses the XEVMPD classification of the reported product and substance information in the ICSR. Therefore, if all information is correct, MAHs don't need to set filter for active substance group if they don't want to. The system, in principle, will retrieve all ICSRs with their active substances. So, in conclusion of this first part, our advice is to filter only by dates and country unless you want to perform a specific search for one active substance. And of course, you should keep your XEVMPD updated at all times. Okay, so now that we know how the filters function, we have to design the search query. Then we can save this query in order to reuse it when necessary with these two buttons. Okay, with this button we can save the query for the future. And with this other, we can load a previous saved query. Okay. So once designed the criteria, the search, by clicking in the button count, we can know in a quick way if our search is going to retrieve results. In this field, we will see a number of results. If the number is zero, keep in mind to register this result in your records to keep traceability that the search was done but not results were retrieved. If there is another number than zero, we can give a name for our request and request the results. Then we have to wait. Sometimes it's much longer than others. And then the system will show us how many results the search will be done. Okay. Please note that the exports are limited to 10,000 results. If your count shows more than 10,000 results with these symbols, then you should add further criteria to refine your results. Okay, so when we have this this number here, we can place a name in the request name and request the results. Okay. Then first your request will be placed as pending, and EMA advises in its user manual that users performing downloads should avoid making repetitive requests for the same set of the ICSRs. So, because that can overload the system and make the system more slower than it is. And therefore, EMA advised that the active request should be left to complete. And if the request is for 2 days in pending, will be deleted by the system. So once finalized the request, it will be moved to resolved area of the history. All requests will remain in this resolved group section and don't get deleted after a month from the date of their creation. They acquire a status archive and cannot be downloaded again. So once completed the request, we need to download it to follow with the process. By clicking in download, we'll compress the file. Okay, so what we get from this download is a compressed file containing E2B R3 XML files, and you already know that if an E2B R2 XML file was kind of difficult to be read, and E2B R3 is like a mission impossible. So for visualizing these XMLs before entering them in the database, we can use the workspace U tool here in the EV web. This tool acts as a temporary centralized area where multiple EV web items can be added for better review and management. Be aware that the workspace screen retains the added EV web items only during the active EV web session. If a user logs out or terminates the session, the workspace screen will clear all previously added items. Therefore, with the import function signal that it is this button, we can upload our R3 XML that we got before. These XMLs will be displayed in the messages tab, and when you click on the message, you will see that you can manage the safety message in several ways, like open, create an acknowledgement, edit, remove from a workspace, and you can also export in XML or RTF format. Okay. Okay, so when clicking in open, this option will change to close, and the safety message will be displayed in a typical read-only tree view and active area format. This option can be used to navigate through the ICSR and to decide if the case should be entered or not in your database. Other option is exporting the safety message in RTF format, which is an abbreviation of rich text format. When clicking this option, we obtain a Word document with all the completed fields. Okay, so let's keep going and let's talk about the types of cases that you can retrieve from these searches. We have local agency cases, mass submitted cases that can be from spontaneous sources from healthcare professionals or consumers or from literature, and master cases submitted by EMA. As you may already know, they can be detected for the name of the message. However, we cannot differentiate between the local agencies cases and MA cases. Regarding local agency cases, these cases can be detected by the code of the agency in the sender's case safety report, unique identifier, and other fields can be used to detect these cases, like the information on sender of the case. And remember that when filtered by organization type is functional, we will be able to filter by NCA cases. Regarding mass submitted cases from spontaneous sources, these cases can be detected by the organization name, organization ID, of the sender's case safety report unique identifier file. Other fields also can be used to detect these cases, like first sender's case in classified as other, and information on sender of the case. We can find also cases submitted by MAHs from literature searches. These are cases from local literature screenings, cases from global literature screenings for active substances that are not in the MLM list, and cases from global literature screenings in journals not included in the MLM service. These cases can be detected by the literature report box at the end of the RTF. Or in the field of literature references in the workspace. And remember that when filtered by organization type is functional, then we will be able to filter by non-NCA cases. And finally, we have the master cases. Master cases are the result of the duplicate check activity performed by agency. Duplicate cases are generally managed through a process of merging two or more cases into one master case. The approach taken by the agency is managing duplicates in EudraVigilance is the following. When detecting two or more duplicates, generates a new case called master case. This master case should reflect the most accurate and up-to-date information available to the organization. This master case also is the version of the case of a case which is valid for pharmacovigilance purposes. The other cases will be listed in the other case identifiers fields. These cases can be detected easily by the message number, which is different from the rest of ICSRs. Okay, so it seems that we are entering a lot of data that would be then removed due to the finding of a master case. We should handle all these results in a practical way in order to save time. So don't panic, breathe and triage. And also remember to record all activities, all your activity. During triage, you must establish your exclusion criteria. You can exclude that the case is related with your product if the ICSR give a brand name that is not yours, if your company is not marketing yet the product in the current country, if the dosage form reported in the ICSR is not the one approved for your product, if the route of administration is not the one approved for your product. Here we have to be careful due to the possibility of the medication error cases and should be studied case by case. And finally, if your ICSR has been already downloaded or it is a part of master case already downloaded. All these exclusion justifications should be registered in order to remember the reason why an ICSR was excluded in the past. So record your activity. Once we have decided that it cannot be discarded, that the case is related with our product, we have to check if the case has been entered in the database already or not. This can be done first manually looking for the worldwide ID and checking if the other case identifiers inside the case have been already entered. Some cases can have two other case identifiers and it can be easy. However, the number of other case identifiers is not limited and we can find cases with an excessive list of duplicate numbers to check. And once entered in the database, check duplicates following your SOPs. Okay, so did I mention that you should register all your activity? We think that with a simple Excel file with these columns, for example, you can register all these activities and decisions that we have been going through during all the process. For searches that retrieve no results, a simple screenshot of the result of the search would be enough. Or you can also have another tab in the Excel where you can register each screening and how many results do you have. Okay, so now we have our case ready to be entered in the database. So it passed all the exclusion criteria and we cannot disregard this case that could be related with our product. Okay, so, but in that moment, several questions could come to our heads, like, day zero, which day zero should I enter? RTF says a receipt date like a month ago, but my day zero, I am aware of this case right now. Should I perform medical assessment? What is the narrative? Should I write one? Validation? We have to answer to these questions and to establish the procedure of the data entry of this case before entering it in our database. So regarding the day zero, what is mentioned in question number 2.3 of questions and answers document of the agency is that pharmacovigilance legislation that doesn't define a day zero for ICSRs accessed via EudraVigilance by MAHs. Therefore, we can use the day of downloading as day zero, which is the same decision that that EMA says for the day zero of MLM cases. It should be taken into account that this day zero only applies for internal communication timelines with partners and for our case management internal procedures. Due to this, this case is already submitted to agency, so we don't have to resubmit this case. About the narrative, these cases don't have narrative available and it cannot be requested unless they were involved in a signal evaluation. In addition, these cases cannot be detected easily inside our database. Therefore, maybe it's a good idea to write a little narrative collecting this information. About the medical assessment, is medical assessment necessary? Is there enough information without the narrative to perform a medical assessment? And validation, if you have implemented a case validation quite exhaustive per procedure, should it be the same validation that applies for spontaneous reports received directly in your company? These cases are already in EVWeb, therefore they have passed a validation already. All these questions, and more that I am sure there are, lead us to the conclusion that these cases should be handled separately and should follow workflows defined specifically for them. So, in conclusion of this webinar, our recommendation after almost 4 months of experience with the new environment is that these cases should be treated separately, creating work instructions or SOPs for download, for the triage, and for the data entry processes, and we should also review our safety data agreements with third parties to establish responsibilities and timelines regarding these cases. And always, always, always record all your activity. Okay. So let's see a practical example. Since the search in the EVWeb until the data entry of the case in our database. In Asphalion, we have PCB Manager that is developed by Extido. And now we are going to see how we do a screening in the EVWeb. Okay, so here we have the ICSR download tool. Okay, and then we can do, we can make here the search query, including our countries and then, okay. And then we can save with this one, with this button, and download a file that you can save in your server and then upload it here. Okay? Okay. So what's more? We should we can upload uh, a, a filter previously saved here. Okay, that this is this filter, and then we want to see how many results are in this search query. Okay, so when we have this number, we can give the request a name and then request. Okay, we did it yesterday. So we have here our request that we can download. Okay. And we have here a compressed file. Okay. Okay, so now we want to see this XML. First, we should to unzip the results. Okay, and now here we have all cases, the master cases and the NCA or MAHs cases that are being downloaded. What's more? Okay, so now we are going to upload the case in workspace. Okay, with this button, we can go to our decompress file and check for one of them. Okay. Once we have the message here, we can open it and see which is the sender, and we can navigate here. You can see which case identifiers has this case. And in patient, you can see the drugs and take your decision if this case is going to be entered in your system or not. If you want to save this case, you can export it in a RTF format and save it here. Okay. And then you can see in a more easy way all the fields that are in this case. Okay, so this is what is regarding the EVWeb function. We can go through our database. So imagine that we have checked the case, and we don't have the case before, and this case cannot be discarded for our product. So we are going to enter it in PCB manager database. Okay. Okay, so with file import E2B XML, we can import the case that we have designed. Okay, PCB Manager is in R2 format, and it has the backwards forwards conversor that IMA publishes, so there is no problem to import R3 cases. Okay, we just have to check some fields that maybe are not properly entered in the XML. Directly. Okay, so the case is successfully imported. We have here the new case, and we have to block the case. Okay, and then we can check the data. We can check first the data, okay, like day zero, that for importing PCV manager gives the day of entering in the case in the database. So, but if we have some delay between the downloading and the entering in the database, we can just change this date for the correct one. Okay. And then we have to check if this box is okay, because these two fields, only one should be complete. The case is serious, so nothing is more. And then we have to write the narrative. Okay. PCV manager gives an automatic narrative. Okay, that put all fields in a narrative style. Okay, we only have to add a statement that this case comes from the EudraVigilance screenings, like this, and put the date. Okay. And then we have a light narrative that can summarize of the case. Okay. So then we have to save the case first, and then we can add this case to a workflow. That, like, this case is not going to be submitted. Is the we have established that these cases are going to enter in non-submission workflow, and this workflow will be done in 60 days. Okay. So we can process workflow, and it enters in data entry state, okay, that we have here. And then we can we check all the data entry, and we can check for duplicates. And like we have here, is not possible duplicates found, so it is okay. And then we can promote the case to validation state. I lost the case, I'm sorry. Where is the case? Well, we can sort the cases in many ways to find it. A ver. So now here, that's mine. Okay, and then we can promote the case from data entry state to validation. Okay. Is going to go to validation, and here we have established that the validation is going to be only the automatic validation that the programs do with this button, and then we see the error and the and a warning. Okay, we have to amend this error This is an internal error because PCD manager, when it's a literature case, we should to check a box that is not E2B field. Okay, but if this box is completed, we have to check that. Okay. Okay, so we already have it, and now we can refresh this result. And now we only have a warning that it's not important to the workflow of the case. Okay, so we can go through and promote the case to finalize state. Okay, so now we have the case already finalized, and then we can, if we have to send it to a partner, we can send them an E2B XML here, export as XML, or we can also make a science report. And we can all here see the science that is more legible, more friendly. Okay. Okay. So I think that's all. Let me here. Okay, so that's all, but I want to thank first to all the team that works hardly in Asphalion's PV unit. They are all awesome and make the pharmacovigilance more interesting if possible. Here we have a guest, an infiltrator, that is Nuria Romero, that is our managing director. Okay. And thank you again for your attention. Thank you for registering. And here you have our contact details in case that you need more information. I hope the webinar clarifies your doubts enough, and I hope we will see you in future. I think we have a question, but if my IT guy can show. Okay, so the question is from Javier. Do you consider the ICSR without marketing authorization trademark are necessary to be downloaded to, or only the marketing authorization trademark ones? I think, Javier, that you have to download all cases that you can exclude that is your product. No, it's not the same question. Okay, I think that if it comes with a trademark, if it is yours, you have to download it. But if it is not come with the trademark, I think you have to put it in your unless you have to download it and study the case. If you cannot disregard this case. Okay, we have another one. Could you clarify if the duplicate search could be performed before download the cases from EVWeb? Is this valid for all kind of cases, or there is any restriction about seriousness or something like that? The duplicate search, you can. I think you mean that the duplicate search in the database, where with the If you have an Excel with many items, you can go through for a duplicate search in this Excel before taking the decision of the downloading. And your second question, is this valid for all kind of cases? If there is any this is valid. I think this is valid for all cases. You can filter about seriousness, but now we have to collect all seriousness, serious and non-serious. So, and the inclusion of a narrative when it is not provided will involve a modification of the initial reported information from regulatory authorities. Yes, maybe. But you are not going to resubmit this case. If we understood, well, as Farian suggested, to include one. Can you confirm? We suggest to include one, but taking into account that the case is not going to be resubmitted. Okay? A ver. And think we have time for two more. From Anna Mercury, we often download cases that have two different ID extensions. Do you know why? And what should we do? ID, two different ID extensions. Can you clarify, Anna? I don't understand. You know the you mean the two different reference numbers? But you know that it's the same case. I don't know. This is when. Okay, I think I. This is because some organizations submit cases that if you know about another reference number, you submit this case with this duplicate case in other case identifiers. But you don't know if this reference number it has been submitted. I don't know if I clarify enough. The second reference number is not in the section other identifiers. Okay, maybe Anna, maybe if you can. Send an email and we can go through this question, because now I don't know what could it be. Okay, so thank you all. Thank you all. This webinar was being recorded. Like you, that you have to record all your activity, and we will send you briefly by email the video recording. Okay, so thank you all for registering, and I hope you see you in future.